Hello, everyone. My name is Jessica Kennedy, and I am the educator for adult learning at the St. Louis Art Museum. Thank you so much for joining us for tonight's program. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program, and we will choose a few to answer at the end. To get us started, I will hand things over to the museum's Associate Curator of Modern and Contemporary Art, Hannah Klemm, who will introduce our featured speaker. Thanks, Hannah.
Hi, everybody. It's so exciting to be here, and I'm just so excited to virtually be here with Dana Levy, and it's a real pleasure to get to share this exhibition with you all, and it is open in the museum, but we're going to give you a little virtual sneak peek if you haven't been able to make it over to the museum yet. So Dana is an Israeli-born New York-based artist who is internationally known for poetic video works, sculpture, and print installations that explore place, displacement, and migration by exposing tensions between architecture, nature, and the environment, and human history. Dana earned a bachelor's degree from Camberwell College of Arts in London and a master's degree in electronic imaging at Duncan of Jordanstone College of Art and Design in Dundee, Scotland. Dana's work examines how the past resides in the present and how the choices we make of what to keep and what is destroyed hold important implications. Her work has been featured in more than a dozen solo shows and film screenings, recent exhibitions at the Friedman Gallery in New York and the Caddis Foundation in San Francisco. And she has participated in more than 60 group exhibitions and screenings all over the world, including shows at the Tate Modern in London, the Centre Pompidou in Paris, the Israel Museum, and the Museum for Islamic Art, both in Jerusalem. In 2008, she received the Young Israeli Artist Award, and most recently, in 2019 to 2020, she was the recipient of the Henry L. and Natalie E. Freund Teaching Fellowship between Washington University in St. Louis and the St. Louis Art Museum. Dana's multifaceted practice considers how historic architecture and sites embody lived experiences and change context over time. And she often begins her projects with specific places, buildings, local people, archives, and then creates works that delve into these unique cultural histories and connect to overarching themes of place across her practice. For this exhibition, which you can see on the screen, Currents 119, Dana started with St. Louis coming out of her Freund Fellowship. And she consulted with members of the St. Louis community from city residents to historians and cultural institutions to make four new works for this exhibition. These works explore how humans interact with historic architecture and perceive traces of the past within buildings. It highlights disparities between what we expect of architecture and urban planning and the real nuanced histories of the built environment. While the artworks in the exhibition started with St. Louis and its history as their conception, the city stands as an archetype for American urban centers. And from there, the exhibition examines broader trends in social, political, and economic structures that affect architecture's preservation and deterioration. Ultimately, the project draws attention to the duality of absence and presence and how we understand our environment. So just to give a little preview, just show you the space, there's several video installations. You can see two of them here. There are two large-scale images that have been projected upon, and we'll talk a little about it, but I'll just walk you through the gallery, and then hopefully it'll give you enough that you want to come back if you feel safe being in the museum to see the rest of the show. So here's the second half of the gallery, another one of the works. You can get an impression of just how the space is laid out. And there's the second video with the two channels. This is the large scale video and then a monitor with another channel video. So welcome, Dana. Should I stop sharing and move on to your PowerPoint, or do you want to stay on this screen for a minute to start our conversation?
I can move to the PowerPoint.
Okay, I'm going to stop sharing.
Okay. thank you, everybody, very much for coming, and Hannah and the museum. I'm really happy to have this opportunity to talk about the show, and I hope you will get to see it in person.
So why don't we start from the beginning with your time in St. Louis and how you, what you kind of, what was your starting point for this show? Coming to St. Louis as a Freund Fellow at Washington University, starting off initially teaching, but also knowing that there was this exhibition coming up at the St. Louis Art Museum. How did you start to think about creating new work within this context?
Yeah, I mean, before I came to St. Louis, I wasn't sure at all what I would do, which makes it all much more interesting for me. I often work in a way where I come to a place and I start to explore. I rarely leave any rocks unturned. I'm very curious by nature. So, but before I came to St. Louis, from what I read, I didn't think I would find it that interesting. But when I arrived and after I spent some time there, I found it to be one of the most interesting places I've ever been to. I started teaching, was really great. I had a really great experience teaching at Washington University with excellent MFA students. And I was struck by the whole city, the beautiful architecture, all the museums, free, the parks, everything was amazing. But then I started to drive around and I found other parts of the city which had the same amazing architecture, but there it was more in a state of decay and neglect and all these layers of time and this erasure of layers upon layers was something that really became the focus point of all of the works in the show. And yeah, I found really interesting. Yeah, I'll show some of these. So this was just like a house in the Central West End. A lot of the architecture is super grandiose. And this is a house. I find it interesting, these two houses, because they're so similar architecturally, but they're in different parts of the city. So here they are kind of abandoned and neglected. And here they're fully renovated. So yeah, I was amazed. This is the water tower in North St. Louis, which looks like this had this empire kind of falling apart. And this is a church in North St. Louis. Here we see a house which, the bricks are stolen because a lot of the bricks are actually worth more than the house.
I was just going to dig in a little on some of those ideas. So you really, as you were exploring the city, certain places started becoming places that you continually explored and become featured in some of the works. But the idea of place and what place means, both sort of in a theoretical construct, but also as an individual, kind of almost emotional context, is something that has been very visible in a lot of your work. Can you talk a little bit about what this concept of place means to you?
When I come somewhere, I really like to explore it and find hidden layers that are not necessarily talked about or presented when you come at first to a city. And in St. Louis, it was these layers, like you had there this ancient history of the city of Cahokia, and then you had the more recent history of like Victorian times and all these amazing mansions. And then there was these neighborhoods that were erased for the sake of urban renewal. So all these layers of time were very present in St. Louis, which I was fascinated by this. And so the more I explored these layers, the more I wanted to kind of touch history, to bring them to life in some kind of way, to go to places which were abandoned and to bring new life into them, or even places that were highly preserved and to kind of go back in time as well. So I was very curious about that.
So you were thinking, that's so interesting when you think of the works, and we can delve into a little bit maybe about the works. Well, we will delve into each of the works a little bit, but it's interesting that these layers come out across the works, but also within each work, that you sort of, one of the things you do so wonderfully is you show both the kind of history through the layers, but it also kind of skips around, that you're really interested in how these ideas shift over time, how they shift in different contexts and locations. And I think one of those ideas is what home means, because home lends a lot of weight to a place. Mm-hmm. And could you talk a little bit about how some of maybe you thought about your earlier work, but how this idea of home maybe played into your thinking about this system within St. Louis that you saw?
Yeah, this notion of home as somewhere temporary or formal is something that repeats itself a lot in my work. It's almost subconsciously, and this sense of in displacement is very much placed in my work. And I read the poem by Shiraz Gorman, which I'll get to later as well, but she wrote a poem about North St. Louis called "Who Moved My Memories," and it also, parts of it appear in the work, but that was almost a very personal thing for me as well, because it reminded me of going back with my father to his hometown in Cairo, and he was looking for his childhood home, and that had been erased, and going back with my grandfather to his home in Poland, which he left from there to Auschwitz, and he had never been back. And that also was like erased. So this whole idea of going back to a place and the memories of your childhood is erased is something that resonated on a personal level. But here, this was happening in America, and these were stories that weren't told as often, or I hadn't heard them so much about. But it's something that the more I researched, the more I realized it was a repeated theme in many cities.
Yeah, that's so interesting. So when you started exploring St. Louis with the background that you have and the background of your work, how did you kind of, and maybe we can go back to some of these pictures you took, how did you kind of come upon your sites? And maybe we could introduce the work that came out of this a little, so that as we build up to it, we can talk a little bit about one of the two videos, Mississippians, that actually came out of this exploration of North St. Louis. So you talk a little bit about finding sites and which sites really struck you and how you kind of chose the backdrop to the video, the location, I guess, specifically.
Yeah, I mean, this house, for instance, on St. Louis Avenue is one of the houses that struck me the most. I mean, I love it. I find, like many artists, I find beauty in decay and this kind of thing. But here, like, nature was blossoming all over North St. Louis. And I wanted to, you know, I wanted to almost take it a step further and make it like of like really nature taking over, like no more humans exist, and now they like they do all kinds of ruins. The locations I looked for places where nature took over, so that it'll look like some faraway future where humans no longer exist and the world is now taken over by nature. This friend, I was looking at all kinds of old masters, for instance, Bosch, with his painting, The Garden of Earthly Delights, here. And I tried to kind of make these, here is my attempt at that, make these, like I was very inspired by these paintings. And should I show a short clip of Mississippians?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is the first channel of Mississippians. I'll show like a 3-minute clip. Thank you.
Wonderful. So you can see how that those themes of nature and architecture, like sort of merging in that video. Can you talk a little bit about sort of how you saw that relationship of nature and architecture emerging in this video and some of the inspiration of that, and kind of what themes that interconnection of nature and architecture really brought up for you in this work?
Yeah, I mean, it's always interesting for me how, you know, we live in homes and we have to really maintain them constantly so that nature doesn't take over. But, you know, the minute we stop that maintenance, like immediately a whole new life, like nature moves in and a whole new life begins. And I always find that fascinating, like these two forces, these two powerful forces, like man and nature, like in this kind of battle. And it's nice to see sometimes where nature is winning and taking over these architectural buildings. I found it beautiful. I mean, and in this video, I actually, you know, even though I wanted to show a fantasy, not the reality of the, not to show like poverty or things like that. I wanted to make it beautiful. In this part of the video, like a fantasy that is more about the beauty of nature, kind of going back to Genesis.
So, you know, you left us on a pretty striking image here. And after looking at some of those Bosch paintings as an inspiration and seeing this clip that we saw, and also knowing some of your older work, animals do play a role as well as a part of this nature, human interaction. Can you tell us a little about the animals? I know they're becoming the number one question you're getting. When we were in the galleries, everyone wanted to know so much about the animals, but can you give us a little insight into the meaning of the animals, the use of the animals, whatever you want to share?
Yeah, I mean, what I love about working with animals is that there's always some kind of risk. Like it's beyond your control to know exactly what's going to happen. And I remember there were moments like they were like, owls, they won't sit in that tree. And I was like, no, they're part of the work. They will sit in the tree. And then they sat in the tree. Like, so I worked also with the bird sanctuary in St. Louis. So these are not like show animals. These are rescues that can't live in the wild because you know, they were poisoned by rodent poisoning. And so it was really interesting to bring this to North St. Louis. And they do have symbolic meanings. You know, here we have the bald eagle, that's obviously symbolic of America. And then for me, the owl is a symbol of like a warning. I remember living in New York, and then just before Hurricane Sandy happened, I had this dream of an owl coming to my window and just staring at me. And wasn't even following the news. And then the next day I heard like a hurricane is coming, and I knew immediately this would be a very powerful hurricane because that owl visited me and warned me in my dream. So for me, owls are like warning, so kind of warning us from this, if we continue this kind of inequality, these kind of injustices, these environmental issues that we're facing, then this is kind of warning us that this future, we might be erased as humans. And yeah, there are some things that don't make sense logically, like the owls and eagles, or hawks and eagles together. So I wanted it to be kind of surreal, for people to think, wait, is this real? Did this happen? People have asked me, oh, wow, you just happened to walk by and saw an eagle there. I was like, yeah, it was my lucky day. But I wanted people to not be sure.
Keep some of the mystery.
Yeah, to not be sure if this actually happened or if it's staged.
Yeah, no, it's both very beautiful, and it does kind of trick you. I know I've multiple times, I'm like, oh, all those animals, and you're like, you know, there's only one of them or whatever, and you're mirroring things. And it's such a wonderful technique because it really does just pull you into the whole narrative as a viewer. Sometimes it's better to know less and to just go with the fantasy. Yeah. so you also, as you were here and researching and connecting with people with this film, you started looking at a far more expansive history of St. Louis than I think you had coming in. And one of those discoveries was the sort of pre-contact history of Cahokia. Do you want to talk a little bit about how you came to the history of Cahokia and what role it ended up playing in this film and how you sort of thought about it?
Yeah, so.
And I guess we could probably give a little background, on Cahokia for anyone joining us who isn't from this immediate region.
Yeah, so first of all, it's interesting that Cahokia is right. You can see in this photo, which I shot from Cahokia, you can see St. Louis there, the arch. It used to be the largest city in the world about 1,000 years ago, or the largest city in the Western world at least. And now it's all that remains are these mounds, which are actually the largest mounds north of Mexico. And people just jog there now. And most people don't even know about this place. But actually how I got to it was interesting because I was looking at these photos from North St. Louis and I was listening to an audiobook about Mayan ruins and kind of this connection of this long, you know, suddenly looking at North St. Louis from an aspect of a faraway future, looking at like, not necessarily the North St. Louis, but the world kind of as this place that once, the civilization that once existed. And I met Michael Allen, he's a historian in St. Louis, and he pointed me to Cahokia. And the more I researched, the more I found kind of parallels, like what made that society collapse. And I spoke, for instance, to Chris Otto, who is a professor at Jefferson University, and I found his TED Talk where he talks about the lessons from Cahokia and how it's similar to issues we are facing today, like what caused Cahokia to collapse. Maybe if we want to go in a different direction, then than Cahokia's fate, then maybe we can learn some lessons from that.
So that's
the building I was looking at.
So that kind of is an interesting juxtaposition to maybe us talking briefly about the second channel of Mississippians. So that video has two parts. One, the sort of large screen projection that you showed the 3-minute clip of, but then on that little monitor screen that you saw in the virtual tour is a second channel of the video. Can you tell us a little bit about the creation of that second channel, what it is, how you sort of came to deciding that this video needed this kind of second monitor and second channel piece?
Yeah, so first there it's placed in the corner next to the projection, and it has its own audio, which you can stand under a directional speaker and hear it. So the first channel of Cahokia is more about fantasy. It's not about reality. It's about this, a fictional reality that I created, and I wasn't trying to represent a specific place. Whereas the second channel, I'm seeking the truth, like what really happened there? Why is it so neglected? I spoke to residents of North St. Louis. I spoke to historians, and I can show a short clip of that.
Yeah.
It's not just St. Louis. There's a North St. Louis almost in every American city.
And I'm going to point the finger at the media here. They tend to tar Black neighborhoods, poverty, crime,
trees and rocks, bushes and berry trees. And my family's home, I grew up with 2 peach trees, 2 apple trees, a grapevine, a strawberry patch. You see these factories closing, this trade happening. Everybody, parents had jobs like at these different places. And then what's that smell that's coming from the room where everybody's playing cards? And it's like, oh, that's the smell of some drug that is a drug.
You been getting any problem I don't face, anything I don't been through, you stood by my side when all I did was offend you. I don't play church, never even pretend to. Repentance, that's what men do. Poor, straight, sinful.
I always say if I want to get a cup of coffee, I'd have to go into a white neighborhood. No Starbucks. So we used to have cleaners, that's not there. We used to have a bakery, that's gone. We used to have an ice cream shop, that's gone. We used to have a laundromat, that's gone.
These are the streets you used to run on, the playground you used to play in, the houses you used to go over, and it's gone. That's heartbreaking. Wait a second, was that a gunshot? Yes, that was multiple gunshots. And then seeing how the young men in our community were starting to get roped up in the underground drug economy.
I'm like, some things I would be given away by the skin of my teeth. Police have kicked in the dope house where I've been in before. You know what I'm saying? I don't have guns in my face. You came to help me save me from myself. For that, I'm eternally grateful. Because without you in my heart, I'm just lustful, prideful, disrespectful, and hateful.
When this whole war on drugs happened, it truly felt like it was a war on Black people in general. Looked like a bomb hit it.
Sorry. So I wanted to understand, I came without any prior thoughts about making a work about these issues, but I wanted to understand why was the city looking like this? Why was this neighborhood looking like this? So I first met Chris, which is in the photo. He was my assistant on the filming. He was the camera assistant. And, you know, he was an excellent camera assistant, but he also was generous enough to let me interview him where he grew up in North St. Louis. So I spoke to him. And then somebody referred me to Shiraz Gorman, who's a poet, and I found her poem online and I reached out to her. And then she referred me to Gwen Moore, and I also met Michael Allen, who I was listening to his podcast and read many articles he had written about St. Louis. And then the last person I interviewed was Chris Otto, who, like I said, I found his TED Talk to be really fascinating and kind of put everything together. So these conversations for me were really the best part of being in St. Louis, like meeting people, inviting them to my home, and just listening. And this part of the video is more about empathy and, you know, kind of trying to understand what's going on. And yeah, it was very, very moving to me, eye-opening to me, a lot of things I didn't know, like understanding these systems that create this kind of reality and how it's repeated in place all around the US, you know, I wasn't aware of all this before. So it was very important for me. And it was I worked the longest actually on this video because it was really a lot of information, and it's kind of put on the side, like almost like in a natural history museum or a science museum, which is giving you a lot of information. Whereas the other video is taking you into a fantasy world, but then, that's that.
Yeah. No, it was a very interesting journey for all of us, I think, to see how these two channels of this one piece kind of ended up working together. And I think it occupies such an interesting sort of spatial arrangement. It's one of those things about the show that I think is really special, is how these two works interact to give this more complete picture, not just the video on its own and not just interviews, but to show them together. So that sort of brings us maybe to the third artwork in that back part of the gallery. This work, Drowned World, maybe we can talk a little bit about it and how, maybe tell us a little bit about this work, and then maybe we can talk about how you see it kind of interacting with the show writ large.
Yeah, so this, what we're seeing here is a stained glass window that I found in a store in St. Louis, like an antique window from early 20th century. And, you know, the minute I saw it, I thought, wow, that looks like a monitor, which is how my brain thinks. And so I bought it, and then it fits in with Mississippians, like the first channel of Mississippians, which is about this fictional future where nature has, like after some apocalypse has happened. And I'll show a video from this. So you can see here, like there's some movement, like basically water is dripping. There's like that animal, which is unclear what it is exactly, or at least for me. And so it's like looking out a window and seeing basically a drowned world. And I gave it the name Drowned World after this sci-fi novel by J.G. Ballard from 1962, I think, which shows like this post-apocalyptic reality where most of the world is underwater and uninhabitable. So that kind of fit in with Mississippians, like where also nature has taken over. And I shot all the footage from this at the herpetarium at the zoo. It's kind of a collage from different shots, which I kind of created to look like an outdoor view.
That's wonderful. Yeah, I love this piece. And it's so, you can just kind of stare at it because it is this like video behind it, but it's also kind of, at first glance, almost static. And then you start seeing all of the movement behind the window. It really does give you this impression like you're looking out your window and something has dramatically changed outside. So it has this kind of temporal element. Maybe we should also talk, like this could connect us to the final two works in the exhibition, which are, we've kind of made about the Campbell House. And maybe we start out by just, how did you even come to the Campbell House? And what was the inspiration for this as a starting point, if you have the image here?
Yeah, so like I said, when I came to St. Louis, history is something I'm very interested in general, but you know, I was seeing all these buildings and I'm reading about the history and about, you know, this grandiose past of St. Louis. And then I found this house online. So I immediately went there and took a tour. And I was amazed by mostly, but because I've been to different house museums around the world, but the most astonishing thing about this one was that everything in the house belonged to the family that had lived there. And that is, I haven't seen that anywhere else. Usually they have things of the era or something like that, but here everything belonged to the family. And then later I read how this came about, where actually the whole city contributed for this place to exist. So, you know, on one hand, buildings were being neglected. On the other hand, buildings were being like hyper preserved. This is the bedroom. And then when I took the tour, the thing that I was most fascinated by were these photos in every room from 1885 that were of every single room in the house were these photos from, you know, these of the house. And something that I'm very interested in, and in a lot of my works, I've been working with these vintage photographs of interiors, like empty interiors. I intervened in them in different ways, like I projected as if nature is falling on the wall, or all kinds of things in there. But here was a house where everything was still in place the same way it was 135 years ago. And so I contacted the director, Andy Hahn, which was extremely open-minded and generous. Really, it was amazing. And he let me go in there and basically set up my camera in the same exact way as these photos 135 years later. And so I filmed myself in the room. And then in the exhibition, I project the video of myself 135 years after the background photo was taken. That's what it looks like in the space. That's Andy, the director also. And this is kind of a short clip of what it looks like. So here we see like a close-up. So it's the video being projected onto the photograph, which we made into a wallpaper. So basically I'm picking up things, I'm turning on lights, I'm lying in the bed, I'm doing all kinds of things. And it's pretty amazing that they trusted me with that.
we tell people, you know, she worked with the director, she got permission, you don't get to go touch everything on your next visit to the Campbell House, but it did make for a beautiful artwork. And one of the things which I think you can see from this video is the video from now is in color and the image is black and white from 135 years ago. Can you talk a little bit about some of the ways you use either light or color or projection that create these like ghostly overlaps of time and history? You've done this a few times in your work of using different layers of projection, but this one is so amazing because it's such a one-to-one image. You were telling me, and maybe you have a little more to say on this, they used the photographs to restage the room. So it really is almost like, it's amazing how precise the overlays are with these two, with the projection onto the photograph.
Yeah, I mean, basically I was like a kind of a ghost visiting from the future in these photographs. And I'm always looking for that. I mean, even I'm always looking for the most real experience I can have. I mean, even that's what also drew me to North St. Louis. I wanted to go there to see, to experience, not read things. And I want to touch history also here. I want to touch it as closely as possible here on. And yeah, it's interesting that, you know, we see these photos, so much information is missing, like from the photo. If you just see the photo, you don't know what painting that is there. You don't know what color the wallpaper is. You don't know a lot of things, and the projection gives a lot of missing information.
That is really interesting.
Yeah, I can
move. Yeah, it's also the way it gives movement to the static.
Yeah, yeah, it's kind of surprising. Like you look at it, you don't see it at first. And then, here I'm gonna turn on and off the light.
And there's two very different scales in the room too. So one of them is more kind of intimate and wall sized, and the other, we, you know, you had us blow up one of these images to beyond life size in a way. Can you talk about how you thought about scale?
Yeah, I mean, I've done a lot of these projection works where they're small, and I just thought, okay, this is a museum. This is my chance to try and blow it up life size and to really experience, you know, where you're looking into a room, which could be, it's like a window to, you know, you're looking at this place. It's like a time machine you're basically looking at. But the whole space, the way I see it, is kind of divided into these almost like two parts of the city. On one hand, we have this super preserved part, and the other side is more the neglected part. And we have the past, which I deal with, and then the future and the present. So also all of that, these layers of time kind of exist in all the works.
Yeah. So it's interesting because in addition to those themes, there's also these kind of binaries of interior and exterior, of nature and architecture. Can you maybe build a little on what ended up, maybe I'm kind of throwing you a curveball. This might not have been totally what we prepped about, but I'm interested. What do you feel like at the end of seeing all this work together? Is there something that surprised you in after installing it about the work or thinking through some of these things?
Yeah, for instance, how they really about the ended division. Up. Sorry.
Coming really visually work in this.
Oh, I'm sorry, you were cut off.
Oh, where did you lose me? Sorry, I think my internet glitched. Sorry, world.
Okay, the whole thing that you just said.
Oh no. I was just interested in whether there was anything that surprised you in the end when we were really thinking through a lot of these themes, interior, exterior, nature, human, or architecture. This show really embodies a lot of those things that you think about in your work. And I'm just curious, in retrospect, after seeing the installation and really thinking through all of the work that was done.
Yeah, I mean, well, firstly, when the show, only when the show was up, like, then I said, wow, this is actually like this division of the city. There's a wall in there. They're so close, but there's a wall there. That wasn't intentional, but suddenly I realized that there is this division of the space. And what I enjoyed is that these are themes that I've been working on for years. Like the past decade, I've been working with interiors, I've been working with nature taking over, I've been working with animals. And so I was happy that these are themes that I work on, and you know, I found everything I was interested in right in St. Louis. Like, It's the most amazing place I found. And also I really enjoyed, I hadn't worked with people for a long time. Like, I love people, but I've always been, I used to have a lot of people in my work, and then I kind of stopped having people in my work because, you know, you have to really give them a voice and make sure it's not just me trying to make them into something they're not. So I realized how much I love working with people and how much I want to bring that back into my work. Yeah. And it was interesting because after, you know, I shot all this stuff in 2019, and then COVID happened, and, you know, a lot of these issues came up. Even, you know, suddenly Chris Hill told me, it looks like you're like, you saw it, now it looks like it out here, like nature's taking over, like you don't see people on the streets anymore. And then all these issues of injustice in the US came up, and that was something I was working at. So it was interesting how I shot it all at the end of 2019, but then in 2020, it kind of became a reality all across the country and the world. A lot of these issues were brought to the surface.
Yeah. Yeah, it really did take on a new layer of relevance. So I guess we have a few minutes before I want to bring, I think we've, I've seen some questions come in, like a few questions. So I want to give us some time for that, but we do have to plug your other exhibition at SLAM, which is the new media series, which is showing an older work called The Weight of Things. Do you want to just, we didn't bring a clip or anything, so you'll have to go. You added one.
This photo, but it's an animation work where these are the top one is the actual print. It's also a 19th century print of an interior room at the Versailles Palace. And in the video, you see this whole room in the state of an earthquake until it ends up like the bottom image. So these are all this theme of, like, first of all, there's the theme of the environmental issues, global warming, like earthquakes, that comes in there and kind of destroys this interior. But also like this, you know, this place that's being super preserved on one hand, on the other hand, it falls apart. So this is, I found that this to be pretty relevant to the show, this work, but it's in, you should see the work because these are just two stills from it.
Yeah, it's definitely worth seeing. And the soundtrack is an actual soundtrack from earthquakes, right? And so you actually get that real visceral feeling of hearing the rolling earthquake as you're watching this 19th century print come to life, and then all of the architectural elements kind of collapse to the floor.
Yeah, so maybe I'll stop the share, I guess.
Jessica, do you want? Jessica, do you wanna? Are you gonna?
I can ask some questions. Yeah, and you can
build some questions.
You can leave that up if you want. I think it's okay. You're fine. So we do have quite a few questions. The first one. What was your biggest challenge before, during, and after your completion of filming? And you can talk about any of your projects.
Yeah. My biggest challenge before was, I thought, what am I going to do here? And it was very interesting how things slowly worked out, because I... but it was, the biggest challenge was also like the biggest award, which was like meeting people. There were a lot of challenges, like getting the birds, getting the weather right. I went to a pet shop and I saw all these reptiles, and I said, do you know anybody who can come and lend me the reptiles for a day? Or you know, worrying about the leaves changing colors, all kinds of things of getting it. But there was, I found like so many, first of all, it was so many generous, amazing people that helped me do these works. I mean, the church there, for instance, I met someone called Ben Klein who had just bought this church, and he said, oh, I saw you walking around with all these birds. You're welcome to bring them here. So I met a lot of like generosity and people very open, super open-minded, willing, letting me do all this stuff in the city. So I like challenges. I don't like when things are too easy.
Great. Let's see. Someone asked, how did you design the sound and music for Mississippians? They love the eerie and mysterious tone.
Yeah, so I am lucky enough to have a father who is a musician. So he's a drummer. So he recorded in his studio all kinds of percussions. And then I also met a cellist who I recorded him playing the cello. And then I also recorded like Tibetan bells and like a yoga class. I kind of put it all together and then edited, added effects, things like that. So I often work like that where I collect sounds and then I construct the soundtrack myself. I mean, sometimes I'll work with musicians, but this time, or with composers, this time I composed it myself, but I recorded different musicians.
Did you have the chance to listen to your audience experience your work? Did any reaction stand out?
Not really yet. I mean, I'm very curious because I am kind of showing not always the most positive sides of a place. Although it's not about necessarily one place. So I'm curious to know, but I didn't come with any kind of agenda. I just asked a lot of questions and these were the answers I got.
During your talk, you mentioned that interiors were a recurring subject in your work. Would you talk a bit more about your interest in this theme?
Yeah, I just find it like this blank slate, a place where I can enter and do all kinds of things in. I mean, I have a work where it started when I found these photos of interiors from the 20s, and that was also right after Hurricane Sandy. I started to project on them like rain coming in and then the windows blowing and stuff like that. I find it like a landscape or like a canvas, which I can then, it's a space that I can kind of control. There are walls and there are things there that I can go in and do things. It's like a fantasy world.
Sorry, just making sure we're scrolling through all of them here. Let's see. Why do you think people from outside of the U.S. see things that Americans don't seem to want to acknowledge? They said you're almost being like an anthropologist.
I mean, I think it's like that everywhere. Every time you have a fresh eye somewhere, and even Shiraz told me when I reached out to her, she said that was one of the reasons she replied, because she said you had this kind of naivety, like what happened here? That she was, you know, it wasn't like, oh, tell us about this. So, like, it was clear that I don't know enough and that I'm really genuinely curious. So I think everywhere you go, if you're not local, if you come to a new home, you'll see things that the person living there would never sees even.
Okay, and I think, let's see, we've got, what was the most unexpected thing about your time in St. Louis?
I fell in love with St. Louis. Like, I really fell in love with St. Louis. I fell in love with the people I met, with, you know, the good, the bad, every part of it. Before I came, I really thought this place isn't, I usually go to places that have something kind of extreme about them. And then I, but I thought this place wasn't even gonna be that interesting. And like I said, I found so, it's like the heartland of America. It's a symbolic place. So many things began there. So many, there's Cahokia, there's so much there. To explore, and it's really like a symbol of many other places. So yeah, the most interesting thing for me was, meeting the people for sure, but also just finding so many layers of even when I was there now putting up the show, every day I went and I took photos like on my way to the museum. I just can't get enough of how, I don't know, it's just like, I guess it's a place good for me because it has a lot of things that I'm interested in.
Yeah, that's great. Let's see. Why birds and reptiles and no mammals?
Well, I did actually, one day we drove out of the city and I found a place that had a tiger and I asked them if they were willing to bring the tiger to St. Louis, but they declined. So I guess it's for those, for those reasons, but also, you know, birds are something that also appear a lot in my work. And reptiles were really inspired by the Bosch paintings. So that's what made me go out. And also reptiles, like, you know, do like the climate in St. Louis wouldn't really have, you wouldn't really find like lizards going around like that, or I don't even know all the names of all the reptiles I brought there, but I like this kind of dissonance of that doesn't really fit in with a place.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I think this is going to be our last question. How and why did you choose to use film/video as your medium to portray your art? Is there a different art form that could tell the same story you set out to capture?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, I've been working with video since I was at college. Because I think I like to be innovative. So I started out even as a painter, but I felt like I could never be innovative enough with painting like I can with moving image. And all of the works in there, they each use video in a different way. You know, one of them is a monitor with a window in front of it. One of it is projection onto a print. One of it is just a straightforward video. Like each one I use kind of video in a new way, but I like video because I can be innovative with it. But yeah, I mean, maybe you could tell it in a different way. I'm sure you could, but I like to have that part of it. It's my specialty, and a lot of artists come from photography and then move to video, but I actually started with video. It went from painting to video.
All right, well, Hannah, do you have any closing comments, thoughts?
I just want to say thank you so much to Donna, but also I think Donna and I would both really like to thank Michael Freund, who I think is with us, for his continuing support of the Freund Fellowship at SLAM and Washington University, and the whole Washington University Sam Fox crew, who I think several of which are present. So thank you for everything that you do with the Freund Fellowship.
Yeah, for letting me have this incredible experience in St. Louis. I hope a lot of you get to see the show in person.
I agree. Well, thanks to both of you, Hannah and Donna. This was fabulous. And thanks to everyone who joined us this evening. If you enjoyed tonight's program, I encourage you to register for our annual celebration of Women of Color in the Arts, which will take place in a couple days on Wednesday, March 10th at 7 p.m. The program is titled If It Wasn't for the Women, Ancestral Threads, and it will feature three fiber arts artists in a panel conversation with the museum's Romare Bearden Graduate Fellow, Victoria McCraven. So please check under the events tab on slam.org to learn more. And thank you all and have a great evening.
Thank you.